With more than 35 nations, 30,000 people, and a million components working together, we share one simple goal: to illuminate the way to new energy. It's been likened to the filter of a swimming pool and an oversized ashtray. It's been called alien in shape and hellish in its affinity for heat. Others describe it lovingly as a plasma toilet. But whatever your analogy of choice, the ITER Diverter is an impressive product of scientific, engineering, and logistic ingenuity, designed to exhaust contaminated particles from the plasma to maintain the fusion reaction inside the tokamak.
I understand analogy is important to communicate, yeah. But this analogy of ashtray, well, is a bit negative, no? We have ashes from the plasma which are pumped away at the level of the diverter, okay, but to reduce the diverter to an ashtray, I think it's a bit offending for this nice structure, yeah.
The diverter, one of its purposes is to let the particles that are in the plasma, that get formed and left behind in the plasma, that they'll get sent into these little gaps.
And then you have a diversion to ensure that the convection with the particle is here and not anywhere in the wall.
And then there's a specific little hole for them to come out, and that way it's kind of helping keep the plasma pure.
So diverter is like a heat exchanger. Why? Because this is in the tokamak, where the particles finally are touching the wall. And then it makes this a fantastic heat, up to 20 megawatt per square meter in our load specification. 20 megawatt per square meter is incredibly high. Terrible, you can imagine. So you need technology able to extract this power, which is in one hand very robust, of course, and in another hand quite innovative. I mean, you need steel, a big steel structure to resist with a cooling inside, of course, to remove the heat.
So for that, we have this material, which is a tungsten with a ring of copper inside, and we have many monoblock like this in the diverter, and the goal is to join these two material, so we need to extract rapidly the thermal load here.
And we have the internal cooling of the plasma fission units and avoid the melting of the tungsten.
One way we found, let's say, is to promote turbulence on the water which is circulating in the structure of the diverter to absorb the heat. For example, I just have this in hands, and with this kind of swirl, you can increase the movement into the water, and knowing that the heat flux is coming only from one side, you help in removing the flux.
So you have the inlet water going, circulating along the cassette.
And you see the strange shape of the diverter with this kind of V. To define this shape, you need a very deep understanding of plasma wall interaction, understand how the particles are moving around, what is the best angle, what is the best shape to ensure pumping.
And here we are defining the geometry of the components, so we are always improving the components, and we are always analyzing again and again the components in order to be sure that the new design is able to withstand the huge loads that we have.
The cassette consists of four basic parts.
This is the body, and then we have the inner vertical target. It's at the inboard part of the cassette, IVT, OVT, and the last one is the dome.
And then there's a bunch of diagnostics that also need to get assembled here, so a bunch of sensors and cables. We'll be receiving over 300 components from all over the world, and we have to somehow put them on here. The diverter is a huge puzzle in itself, because every single subcomponent is a person, is a culture, is a history. The dome has a procurement agreement with Russia, so RFDA. The dome will basically come in and go here on the cassette body.
So dome is not like a place the people live. Dome is just plasma which located above of the diverter cassette make influence on the inner target, on the outer target, and of course on the dome. So the purpose of the dome to get the thermal radiation from plasma. That's why the structure is designed not on the limit, but close to the limit of practical capacity.
Next, we have the outer vertical target. There's a lot of tungsten monoblocks here, and they are procured with the Japanese DA. This is going to go in here.
The three the main difficulty in such component. First one is high heat flux technology. Second thing is leak tightness, as all the component water cooled. The last point is high tolerance on the component geometry.
And then we have inner vertical target. Essentially, it has the same tungsten monoblocks on here. And this one is procured with F4E. So, and then this one just goes.
So at this time, in 2020, we have four IVT prototypes ongoing in Europe, in Italy, in Germany, and in France as well.
And that's really important to get this feedback from the prototypes because we are facing no technological and technical difficulties that we share with FOA, and we find solutions, technical solutions. The suppliers are actually providing solutions.
To check this this path is checked in the IFREMOF Institute, in the facility, IFREMOF facility, to validate this technology.
The principle of this test is to mimic loads to which the component is exposed in the machine. It was a long time ago, our partners in this, they have produced so-called small-scale mockups of a real target, of a real PFU. The next step, where we are now, is the performance test, so-called performance test, of the full-scale prototype with all the tolerances, with all the combinations, with all the challenges. So what we do, we manufacture a number of units, we mount it on an educated structure, we send it to the test facility where we expose it to the operating conditions which mimic the real conditions in the machine. And we have performed this test for the Japanese targets 1 year ago. End of 2019, we have completed this major step for one of the European suppliers. Now we do the same test for Russian. This is a major step which allows us to qualify the technology before the series production can start.
The European manufacturers are also providing other PFU, small-scale ITER-like PFU, active liquid, which are a bit smaller than the full IVT PFUs, but actually still relevant. And this small PFU will be tested just next door in CEA by the West joint team. So this PFU will actually sustain real plasma load, and we will learn a lot from these experiments done in West under long pulse, long plasma pulse.
Although the ITER vacuum vessel is so heavily guarded with plasma-facing armor, hundreds of sensors will still peek between the cracks to monitor the conditions inside and transmit data to scientists in the ITER control room. Many such diagnostic and operational instruments interface directly with the diverter using state-of-the-art fiber optic cable technology.
For our purposes, we need to measure mechanical properties and install a set of sensors, for example, strain sensors, temperature sensors, displacement sensors.
The purpose of these measurements is to understand the behavior, structural behavior of these components. So we should have sensors, cables, special equipment to penetrate the vacuum boundary through the vacuum vessel, because, well, for ITER, nothing is easy, nothing is simple.
Optical fiber sensors may work under great radiation, not only gamma, very extreme neutron radiation. For example, this sensor was tested up to 1 gigagray in Kazakhstan reactor. Not exist such type sensors anywhere.
Once the cassette assemblies are fitted with plasma-facing components and sensors, they must then be inserted into the tokamak with robotic handling tools through the narrow ports of the vacuum vessel onto carefully aligned rails. So researchers at the VTT Technical Research Center in Tampere, Finland, spent years practicing with a full-scale mock-up of a fully loaded cassette assembly on their diverter test platform.
As you can see, this is the penetration on the vacuum vessel, and it's passing just a few millimeters from the bottom, a few millimeters from the roof of the port. So we have to properly define the geometry with defined tolerances in the assembly drawing. Then when the robot will take the component, it could do it properly.
As the diverter section nears the end of the prototyping phase, This month, members of the team visited CEA Cadarache, next door to the ITER worksite in France, where as part of a site support agreement between ITER and the French government, a cassette body prototype, procured by F4E and built by the French-Italian firm Sinem Simic, recently underwent final qualification and approval.
So this is a divertor team in front of a piece of hardware here. This is a cassette body prototype, and we are very happy to see this, you know, dealing with paper every day, and this is changing a lot, so we can touch this, and we are so proud of this first component.
So that's why everybody has gloves, because you cannot refrain from going and touching the component physically.
It's always fun and it's rewarding to be able to actually see the component after years and years of paperwork and prototyping and so on. But it's also, we're learning and we're seeing, oh, I need to go and look at that again. Oh, what are we doing there?
So we did the repetition of some of the dimensional inspection on the components. And we also tested the component for leak, very, very stringent criteria. And now we can say that both of them have been passed successfully, which is great. This is the real end of the, let's say, of this loop of producing a prototype, where we have first verified that we can manufacture the components that will allow us to transfer the ownership of the component from F4E to IO. So we finally say, okay, this is good. You have done a great job. Thank you very much.
This is the beginning. We have to build 58 like this. 54 to put in the tokamak and 4 as spares. So it's a long way now.
We already know that it's going to require unique solutions because there's a difference between what we plan and design and then what we receive and what we get as built components.
I don't like surprises, but life gives these surprises for us. That's why all our life is to find the compromise between what we want and what is possible to do in reasonable time.
So our time frame is 2028, but 2028 is tomorrow if you look at our schedule. So if you want to keep this pace, you need a good team.
The Divertor team, we are all very different, but I actually like working with all these people. Except Alain, no, sorry, it's just a joke, you can cut it.
Like Sophie said, this is a very, very nice environment to work. First, we work for a very nice project, great project in the world. In our team, yes, you are very lot of people with different educations. So we have a lot of support between us.
And I like that. Different parts, different pieces that are very unique. Each one has its own requirements, its own almost personality.
I'm very lucky. I have a fantastic team. It's clear. No, I'm not saying this because this is an interview and blah, blah. No. Look, I have a mix of women and men, of young and old, of European, Japanese, American, Russian. It's amazing to see that how after years, I'm here since 10 years now, you are not fed up with this. It's exciting every day.
Well, I mean, it's already 12 years. And I had a lot of interaction with different people, different culture, background, how to argue and how to bring a conclusion together is very interesting.
And we're working now practically 10 years with these people. We communicate each other, of course, because similar problem, similar technical solution.
As a mechanical engineer, to work on Diverto is something amazing. It's a motivation to arrive to work and see that you have a new challenge to face and you have to find a new solution to solve the issue.
Each day you face some new tasks that you still don't know how to solve.
On mechanics, on hydraulics, on neutronics, on remote handling.
We should work on all these topics in parallel, so it's quite exciting.
This is the reason we are engineers.
Yeah.
Bonjour, welcome. That's the end of the video. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this episode about the diverter section. Hope you learned something. I certainly learned a lot in the process of making this and interviewing everybody. And I feel like the diverter is my new favorite component here at ITER, but it's really not fair because there's just so many cool components and stuff here. But it's just, it's the new one. Oh, so You may notice Tomomi's not with me today. She's off in Japan. So I played this video on the green screen here to hopefully distract you from the fact that it's just me this time. But I don't actually have a lot of time for questions this week, but please keep them coming. I really just want to give you an idea of what is coming next on ITER now. So, for example, the next couple episodes will be, we took a field trip, so we got off the ITER work site, went just a few feet down the road, a few meters, I should say, to CEA Cadarache. So if you don't know, CEA, and I'm gonna try to say this in French, forgive me in advance, but it's the Commissariat à l'énergie atomique et ou énergie alternative. Forgive me. The Alternative Energy and Atomic Energy Commission of France, CEA. They have many facilities, research facilities across the country of France. CEA Cadarache, it's right next door. I've been over there a couple times the last few weeks and visiting with some really wonderful scientists, engineers, and people over there. Got to stand on top. They have the tokamak too. It's called the West Tokamak. It's smaller than ITER, but they're doing tests over there, not just with the tokamak, but with all kinds of facilities and stuff they have. So we got a couple cool episodes coming out about that soon. And then another one I'm really excited about, which might even rival the diverter as my new favorite component, the tokamak cooling system. So you got a glimpse of how the cooling system works in this episode with the actively cooled pipes, the water going through the pipes and all that. But what happens to that water as it leaves the tokamak at 120 degrees Celsius, where does it go? Well, we'll tell you in the next episode after our CEA episodes about the tokamak cooling system. So it's all very interesting stuff, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. We've got many more videos coming up. Hope you'll be interested and stick with us, and we'll keep trying to come up with some fun backgrounds here. And please keep sending your comments, questions, suggestions. We're all in this together. We truly couldn't do this without you. So thank you for your support and your interest. And see you next time. Thank you very much on ITER Now. Merci beaucoup. Au revoir.